Great. Thanks for introduction. Thanks to Thomas. I have to thank him twice. First of all, for inviting me, and second of all, for allowing me to do non-parallel repetition. So some of you in the audience will have heard about some of the topics of this talk, because the idea of this talk is to somehow show that to some games, there is this mysterious counterpart in the math world, which actually also has a meaning for me, at least, and maybe some few Mohicans here in the audience. But so there is a connection which I want to explain. So if I want to explain the connection, I have to tell you a little bit where I'm coming from. And you know, we had a little chat with Harry. And so I cannot do it without talking about norms. I mean, it's already in the title. I mean, we had a challenge. Can I give this talk without norms? And the answer is no, because that's where the mathematical content comes from, which I want to transmit. So I have to do a translation job here, okay? So bear with me, and please interrupt, because I can assure you that except for a small minority, there will be many things you want to ask, or you never want to ask, whatever. So it's joint work with my Spanish friends, if I may say that. You know, then we have all the names in here, right? And so let's talk about the plan. So I will give you a crash code on Grothendieck's tensor norms. Grothendieck was actually first in functional analysis for, you know, a little intermezzo before he did the really good things. I mean, honestly, but the funny thing is that his work was somehow discovered 10 years later, and then suddenly they discovered this was great stuff. When it was published, nobody cared a damn. I mean, really, it was completely ignored by most of the people. So that's why it's actually a funny story. I will talk about correlations to probabilities. That actually, you know, they have been on the blackboard. I mean, not blackboard. I'm used to blackboard. Sorry, guys. They have been here before in the talk by Jinfeng. He's not here, so I don't have. Okay. And then we will talk about quantum correlations and probabilities and violations, and what I mean by that. Then I will go to these operator spaces. This is, you know, my mathematical home, which I was somehow getting into. And I will explain you why we somehow did what some of you also do. I mean, we just incorporated quantum mechanics in the language, which is, that's a typical logic concept, right? I mean, if you want to talk about quantum mechanics, incorporate it in your language, and then everything looks natural, right? I mean, you don't have to think about non-classical, because you cannot. You're not allowing yourself. And that's the idea behind some of the results. And then I will show how that relates to rank one games. So we start from zero. What is a Banach space? Sorry, I have to bore you. A Banach space is just a complete norm space where you have the triangle inequality. And I'm sure, you know, long time ago, you must have seen this somewhere and you have forgotten it immediately. That's okay. It's just a triangle inequality. And complete is this thing, well, you remember, right? These Cauchy sequences, which are not. Anyway, so that's kind of a Banach space. And then, you know, we want to do this very elementary. So if you have a Banach space, how do you get a new Banach space? Well, you take all the linear maps from a norm space. So if I say norm space, it's not necessarily complete, you know, like, you know, Q and R, right? So if you take all linear maps from a norm space in a Banach space, then the space of linear maps are also Banach space with respect to this well-known operator norm, right? So this is we are talking, Grothendieck was very conceptual, right? So Banach space, new Banach space, right? Let's continue that business. So in particular, if Y is a norm space, the linear maps from Y to K, K here is, I'm working over real and complex fields, not over F2, and so the dual space is also Banach space, because these are linear maps from Y to K, right? Very simple operation. So for every Banach space, there's a dual Banach space. If you do it twice, you get the double dual, and they have the isometric embedding of Y and its double dual, meaning that the norm is preserved. Isometric means same norm. If you have to prove that, you actually have to use this Hahn-Banach separation argument, right? And maybe had some convex geometry, right? And that's a good thing to know. It doesn't hurt to know, okay? And so actually, if you ever wanted to discuss what is the completion of a norm space, go to the bidual, close it up, you're done. That's just exercise, okay? Good. So these are Banach spaces, and we want to copy that part later at the end of my talk. So let's follow Grothendieck. Tensor products. I mean, tensor products is also one of these things which was hated by some of my colleagues, right? They hated tensor product. They liked linear maps. But Grotnik like tensor products. If you think algebraic geometry, tensor products are actually really cool, right? I mean, you have tension space, tensor products, right? You have to do that. So, and of course, he knew that he was going to do algebraic geometry eventually. So what is a tensor product of two Banach spaces? Well, I think you all know that because in the quantum, quantum mechanics, tensor products are very natural. So let me give you, a definition. So how do we put a vector space structure on the algebraic tensor product? By sending a tensor to the bracket map, right? So this is a map from y star to x. I apply the tensor x tensor y to a y star by evaluating this is a scalar times x, right? So that makes sense. And thinking about the bracket vector is okay because you can think of the y being a row vector applied to a column y star, and then what stands over is the x, right? So this the bracket notation, except for the order, which is always a little bit problem if you do functional analysis and linear algebra, it's okay, yeah?
What does it mean, the parentheses around the y in the middle, and what's, like, is it?
Okay, so yes, very good. This here is a linear map, right? So I'm telling you I embed the tensor product in the space of linear maps. So if I define a linear map, this linear map has to act on an element in y star. So how does it act on y star? I take y star of y as a number and multiply it by this vector. So it's exactly action means as a row vector or on a column vector, I get a number, and what is left over is x. Yeah, so that's what I mean. It's that simple, okay?
But y star is a different variable from y, not the
y star is in y star and y is in y.
Yeah, but it's not the map, the canonical map from y to y star, it's individually quantified.
There is no canonical map from y to y star.
There's not?
You're not a Hilbert space, you're a Banach space. Y is completely different from y star. But thank you for the question, very important. Okay. So now here is my formal definition, which I have to do because if I tell you about what is a cross norm, if I follow Grotnik, I have to give you a definition I cannot do without. So a cross norm is a norm on the tensor product so that the norm of x tensor y is not less than the norm of x times the norm of y. And sort of the dual property also holds, which I have written down here. Now, briefly, the norm of x tensor y is the norm of x times lambda y. If you remember that, that's fine, but here's the formal definition if you really want one, okay? Yeah, so a tensor norm, at least for elementary tensors, it preserves the norm. That's sort of the important thing. I mean, and this is a formal way of talking about this, but that's all, okay? Good. So that's a tensor norm. And now, okay, how many tensor norms do you have? There's a largest and a smallest one. The smallest one we have already met. If we have a tensor in x tensor y, right, then we can associate to it an element. I think that up there is not really helpful. So what I'm saying here, I'll write this down again. It's a little bit. What we have seen before was the map which sends x tensor y into the linear maps from y star to x. And what does this map do? It sends x tensor y to what I called x bra y, right? And so this is a linear map, and if you have a subspace here, you can just say the norm of z epsilon is the norm here as a linear map. Call this tz from y star to x. For every tensor, there is a corresponding linear map, and you take that norm, right? So if you have such an assignment, you can extend it linearly to the tensor products. But if you like a concrete expression, that's fine. Yeah, so the epsilon norm, what you do is you take the supremum of all elements of the dual, and the dual, you evaluate it, you get a number, and that's the epsilon norm. Yeah? So you have an embedding of this tensor product in some concrete Banach space. You take the induced norm, you complete, you have another Banach space. Right? A complete subspace of a Banach space is a Banach space. That's all what we do. Okay, so there's the largest one, and that's even more canonical. If you want to define a norm, you know that it has to have this property, norm of x times norm of y is the norm. you have to take the infimum overall, and that's all you can do. Yeah? So there's a smallest one and a largest one.
Sorry, can you go over the smallest one more time?
The smallest one is, I want to do this a little bit more formal. So take a tensor, xk tensor yk, right? Because, you know, if I write it only down for an elementary tensor, we don't really understand what's going on. And then I send that to summation xk tensor yk, right? I mean, that I can do. This is an assignment, which is fine. And then I can calculate the norm of, and I call this map here tz, right? This is a tensor z, and I send it to this linear map. And so what is tz applied to an element y star? That is summation y star of yk times xk, k from 1 to n, say. And that is an element in x. And how do I evaluate the norm in x? I apply a functional in x star. And I'm just writing down this formula because this is symmetric in x star and y star, right? I mean, I want to have symmetry. So that the norm, that you see that if I flip the tensors, x and y, I have the same norm, right? I mean, the norm is flip symmetric, right? And if you calculate the norm of this guy, so you take the supremum over all y star less than 1, and if you calculate here, you have to use one more Hamban-Banach, and you end up with that expression. Yeah? Good. I'm not sure I answered your question sufficiently, but I have to go on anyway. So there is something important, namely...
Actually, so sorry, can I just to prevent you from going on?
Yes, you can.
So can we just go, let's just go to matrix algebras?
I can do that if you give me a second, okay? I'll do that in a second again.
Okay.
Yeah? So because it's actually very helpful, if you take this new tensor product, and you calculate the dual with this largest norm. Forget about the smallest norm. Well, don't forget about the smallest norm. You can calculate the dual very easily, and it's actually the linear map from x to y star, right? I mean, or the bilinear maps from x cross x to the scalars, and that's the linear maps from x to y star. So the largest norm is defined so that the dual is some kind of linear maps from x to y star. And essentially, this is a definition by principle. I mean, you define it in a way that you have that, right? Okay? So just a remark, if you this representation is not unique, and this is why it's an int. There are many ways to write it. And now let's go Hilbert spaces, okay? So I told you that H tensor P, H bar star, you know, these are trace class operators. So the pi tensor product is the trace class operators, and I'm sure you have seen it. Every trace class operator can be written as a linear combination of bra and ket vectors in the Hilbert space, and it's trace class if the sum of these norms are finite. Yeah? So the pi tensor product corresponds to the trace class operators. Now the dual of the trace class operators are, of course, the bounded operators. Now here's a problem. In my old Banach space school, we called it L of H. In the sister algebra literature, they call it B of H. So sometimes you cannot do right by everybody. You just have to tell them that B of H and L of H is the same thing. Okay, it's just, you know, different traditions collide, and you know there's not one way to do this. So B of H is L of H are bounded operators on a Hilbert space. And now let me answer the question which you were somehow looking for. If you have two Hilbert spaces, and you take the epsilon tensor product, yeah? So this corresponds to, the best way is to do actually the same H. These are the compact operators on a Hilbert space with the induced operator norm. Yeah, why compact operators? Because it's a closure of finite rank operators, and you know the epsilon norm for finite rank operators is just the operator norm as a map from a Hilbert space to a Hilbert space. Yeah? And this other epsilon tensor product is just a weird generalization of that guy.
So sorry, you said the epsilon... So
the epsilon tensor product is exactly the class of compact operators.
So the epsilon norm is the operator norm?
Epsilon norm is the operator
and
norm.
What is the
The pi norm is the trace class. The pi norm is a generalization of trace class operators to arbitrary Banach spaces. Yeah? And the epsilon norm is a generalization of the operator norm to arbitrary Banach spaces.
Wait, so maybe this doesn't matter, but what's the difference between the dual of the pi norm and the epsilon norm here?
In finite dimension, none.
Yeah.
In infinite dimension, there are bounded operators which are not compact. Yeah? So, right? Identity, for instance.
Okay.
Yeah? So there are operators which are not compact. That's all. It's just a, you know, this tiny little topological abstraction. Okay, so we have seen bounded operators, trace class operators. There's the smallest tensor norm. There's the largest tensor norm. That's almost all I want. Grothendieck's theorem. Let's talk about Grothendieck's theorem. That's all we know. So he was very fundamental. I think I need the notation, what is the space LP? You know, L1 and L infinity. I think some of you might have seen that before. And so what's the theorem? There's a constant, the Grothendieck constant, so that the pi norm of a certain tensor in L infinity m tensor L infinity m is smaller than another norm. Well, you know, if I just put an arbitrary norm, that wouldn't be very funny. It is actually this gamma 2 norm. So let me just call it gamma 2 norm. So one piece of information, gamma 2 is also a tensor norm. Can be defined for all Banach spaces. It's a tensor norm. So it is always between the epsilon and the pi norm. But here, it's something weird. It's smaller than the pi norm, but only a little bit smaller, right, up to a constant. And the gamma 2 norm is very, very easy. Any tensor here is a matrix, right? I mean, Cm tensor Cm are just m by m matrices after all, right? I mean, linear algebra, I cannot cheat. I can do many things with norms, but, you know, linear algebra, a tensor is just a matrix. So what is the norm of such a matrix? You take the infimum over all possible ways to write the coordinates zij as inner products between hi and kj, where these are vectors in a Hilbert space. And, you know, if you want to have norm 1, you make these vectors all norm 1. Yeah? So that is this fundamental theorem. And people didn't understand that this was a big theorem for a long time.
Sorry, but under the word in, is that an inner product there?
Yes, that's an inner product between Hilbert space vectors.
Okay.
Yeah? An honest to God Hilbert. Yeah? So the good thing is you can really define that in relatively elementary terms. You know? Okay, so that's Grothendieck's theorem.
So the subscript pi there means this is like the pi tensor product.
Yes.
And the pi tensor product of L2 is the familiar operator norm. But the pi tensor
No. If you take L2 with itself, it's trace class operator.
And the pi tensor product of L infinity is?
The pi tensor product of L infinity with itself is a complete miracle, because Grothendieck inequality tells you it's really miraculous.
Why?
Because can we come back to this why later?
No.
Here's a okay.
The gamma two norm. look at these things. I'm not an expert, but somebody told me that's a semi-definite program. Right? Whereas the pi norm, I think, is not. Is that a good answer?
Yes.
For me, it's horrible, but for you, it's hopefully fine.
Just for m by m matrices, the pi norm, can I think of this as, like, the 1 to infinity norm of the matrix? Or, you know, what is there?
You want to do 2 m by m? I mean,
no, just
tensor?
The left-hand side of that, of that inequality, you know, how should I interpret, what's the simplest way to explain the left-hand
okay.
side of inequality?
I have to come back to the pi norm here.
Okay.
Because I have to come back to it anyway, and maybe you like that better.
Okay.
Yeah?
Can I just try to answer the question?
Yeah.
So I think the pi norm is precisely the definition for gamma 2, except that you restrict hi kj to be plus minus 1s.
Okay.
True, but you're taking away my point, so
I didn't
want to say that. Okay, so the dual inequality is actually more interesting. I mean, it was used by Cyrilson, and you know, Cyrilson's bound is based on Grothendieck's work. And so the funny thing is, you know, whenever we have duality, if you have one norm, you have some inequality between two norms, and the dual norms, there's the same inequality. That's how it is. And so I don't want to define it, but it actually turns out, and that was the Sirenson's observation, that this dual norm is very nice. Again, you take the supreme norm, you have such a tensor, and you take here commuting self-adjoint operators, and you evaluate them on a bipartite state. Sounds more familiar? Yeah? So the gamma 2 norm has this very quantum mechanical interpretation. And the epsilon norm is just the epsilon norm, as you just described it. You take the supremum over all plus minus 1s. Okay. So, and you can also say that the epsilon norm is simply taking the supremum over separable states instead of arbitrary states. That's a good way to think about the epsilon norm, if you have this model. But before Sirenson, nobody actually thought about it that way. Okay. So joint probabilities, and here we are getting closer. So I didn't do the picture, I apologize, but you can do these pictures with your PowerPoint much nicer than I. So I really have questions, answers, Bob, referee. And then I have to define what is the classical probability. So these are, you know, these are the questions. I think these are the answers. It's the joint probability and the answer. And so if it's classical, then you just take this average here. I will talk about this in a second, but there are some conditions. For every omega k and l, I want this to be probability distributions for a fixed k. And similarly, I want this to be a probability distribution. These numbers are between 0 and 1, by the way, for every fixed l. And this average here actually really comes from local hidden variables, because, you know, before they, you know, if you want to, in some sense, it's enough to consider these instances for fixed omega. But then the set of probabilities, you know, these large matrices coming from these entries wouldn't be convex. So convex is not nice for me. I like convex sets. But so if you add this average, then it becomes a convex set. But also the quantum mechanical interpretation is maybe you have to consider all possible local hidden variable models. And that would correspond to somehow taking an unknown average over all possible classical theories. And that's why you have to allow averages, because you cannot know in advance which possible local models will ever use. So you allow a convex combination to be sure that, you know, whatever you choose is in there. Okay. So I said that before. So these are you can think of it as a strategy. If you have a question xk, then you answer with a certain probability the answer here. I think that part of my talk is probably very well understood here, so I don't have to dwell on that. And this is the local hidden variable model. And then we have to talk about the value, the classical value of a matrix Z. It's just taking the supremum over all classical probabilities, and then you evaluate that number. So why do you do that? That comes from convex geometry again. You know, you have your classical probabilities. Yeah, here they are. They're actually not round. They're really a convex set. Yeah, so. And, you know, why do you take such a Z? Well, you know, if you have a point which is not a classical probability, then you draw a line, and the line corresponds to the equation of an hyperplane, and the equation of a hyperplane is given by the coefficient Zijkl, because this is all happening in the space r to the n squared times m squared, you know, questions, answers, right? So, you know, this is where these, so this is linear separation. I mean, nonlinear separation, I don't know nothing about it. I don't think it's uninteresting, but I just don't know anything about it. Okay.
Maris?
Yeah?
So this is a game. You're thinking of it.
This is a strategy. Yeah, that's a game. Well, I mean, well, depends. I think game usually has some restrictions. I think sometimes in games you only allow coefficient Zijkl to be positive, right? And or plus minus 1, no, positive, probably 0 and 1. Yeah, that is the only, I mean, I allow arbitrary matrices, but the only difference between games is, I mean, this Z is somehow what the referee does, right? I mean, he wants to check whether the answer is correct or not.
Is it like a payoff function?
Yeah, and then you know, from a Banach space perspective, I can allow any Z, but, you know, for a particular game, you would make some restrictions.
One way to think of Zijkl here is that k and l are questions, I and j are answers, and the z is just a number which is your payoff if you give.
Yeah, you have the payoff. I mean, the z incorporates both the payoff, your, and the initial probability distribution, which the referee feeds to the the question. I mean, so it's a combination of the both. It's the payoff fashion plus the probability distribution combined in one. Yeah?
So then your game is just this big matrix.
Yeah, the name, exactly.
Just a comment on your earlier non-linear separation. So I know there are quadratic separations by some Nobel laureate. Mm-hmm. And there are also degree six separations by a non-Nobel laureate like me.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, thank you. Okay, so there's of course this question of normalization, which from my point of view is very trivial, but it's in fact not so trivial. I mean, if you talk about an optimal value of a game compared to, but I don't really want to dwell on that. Let's talk about the difference between probability and correlations. Now that's a very funny distinction, because if you talk to experimentalists, there is no difference. It's just not there. Now from a mathematician, there is, because you're taking very special tests, right? I mean, so if you remember before, we had this very long matrix, I, J, K, L, and now I'm somehow killing two variables. How do I kill two variables? Because I'm taking the supremum over all objects from before. So let me write this down more precisely. So correlation, the value of a correlation is the supremum of, you know, the N is sort of the game. It's a correlation game now. Okay, so for you guys, I have to say I'm answering this plus minus one instead of arbitrary answers. So I only have two possibilities for answers, but my choice for answers is plus and minus one and not 0, 1. That makes a little, I mean, constant change a little bit, I think, right? So it's a game with answers plus minus one. And then a classical correlation is just, and now we are coming back to what we had before. So we are taking an average of epsilon k of omega, delta j of omega, where there are plus minus one variables, right? So it's all linear convex combinations of vectors which have entry plus minus one. And that's exactly what you talked about before. And you know, here's the translation. The classical correlations exactly correspond to the unit ball of the pi tensor product L infinity M tensor L infinity M, and that's why I didn't want to say it, right? So, you know, the pi tensor product is as mysterious as a set of classical correlations. It's the same set, right? If you allow plus minus one answers, if you allow 0, 1 answers, you can relate them, but they're, you know, it's not exactly the same, okay? Conceptually, it's the same, but not as set, right? And that's the difference between the 0.85, which we have seen here so often, and the square root of 2, which you will see in a second. Okay? Yeah?
Do you mind if I just reformulate that for the, just from my perspective? What would your point, just your main point there, is just saying, I mean, for us, this would be an XOR game, for example, right? Except you're thinking that the answer is as plus minus 1. So this XOR game, it's just represented as a matrix, right? That's the matrix.
Yeah, that's our matrix. I mean, we want to calculate the value of the matrix by maximizing over all classical correlations.
Right, so the classical value of the game is this, what you noted, W of M, right? Mm-hmm. Just optimizing over classical strategies. And your main point there is that this classical value is actually a natural norm of the matrix, right? This the pi.
The value of M is M, sorry, is exactly, so since this is the unit ball of that space, it is the norm in the dual space, you know, if you maximize over everything, so this is the norm of M in L infinity, sorry for the repetition here. Yeah, because the dual of the pi is the epsilon if the dimension is finite, yeah? Remember, you asked whether, you know, in finite dimension, dual of pi is epsilon, and that's actually the way you have to remember it, right? Pi and epsilon are dual to each other.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah? Before making you repeat it, sometimes it's hard to keep track.
Yeah, pi and epsilon are simply dual. If you do epsilon, the dual, you get, take the dual, you get pi. For finite dimensional spaces, for infinite dimensional spaces, you have to do a little bit careful, but you know, finite dimensional, epsilon, pi are dual, period. So since you're taking the supremum over the unit ball, you get the dual norm, and the dual norm is take the dual here, take the dual there, change pi to epsilon. That's what we did, right? And we're going to do that more often, right? I mean, that's the whole point. Okay, so let's talk about quantum probabilities. We have essentially already seen how to define them. They were on this wall before. So now instead of classical probabilities, we somehow evaluate I think I was too generous here. I should have taken the same vector xi, because you like positive objects, but I mean that's actually a little bit of a debate. But so I was too generous with allowing an arbitrary eta there. But so we have to take two times a vector in an entangled Hilbert space, and we assume that the ti k's are a POVM for fixed k. The sj's are a POVM for fixed l. All positive semi-definite matrices, which sum up to the identity or less than the identity, that is not so important. And then the correlation is simply, so that's a quantum probability, right? And a correlation is easier because somehow the coefficients ij disappear, and instead of a plus minus one answer, we take self-adjoint contractions. And why that? If you have a self-adjoint contraction, you can do an eigenvalue decomposition, and by convexity, you can assume that they're only plus and minus one. I mean, this is a convex set, and then so that's why, you know, plus minus one vectors correspond to contractions, and you can think of them. You know, that's why for some experimenters, the difference is not so big. If you have your probabilities which you measure, and then if you sum them up, you get, you know, with a certain configuration, you get your answer plus minus one. I mean, if you average the probabilities you measure, you get exactly these correlations. And the of course, the CHSH is measuring correlations and not probabilities, really. But okay, so this is quantum probabilities and quantum correlations. And then I have drawn here the set. So, you know, if you want to know, is every quantum correlation a classical correlation? Well, if it's not so, then you have to find a separating hyperplane. So what I want to study in the future is something similar. You can ask the question for correlations. You can ask the set questions for probabilities. Is every quantum probability a classical probability? If not, we have to see such a picture, right? If we see such a picture and we decide that the classical probabilities have a center, then you can somehow also talk about the ratio. I mean, how far are these lines apart? You know? And what we are interested in is a large ratio, so multiplicative violation. Now, that might depend on the center, it's not so important, but the real interpretation for some of my quantum information friends is, of course, multiplicative large violation means robust violation. You know, even in a very large neighborhood of my point, you will never see a classical point. So they translate that into a slightly different meaning of robustness, which has been used this morning. But it's some version of robustness. So large multiplicative violation. So having large multiplicative violation is good because it's some form of robustness. You can perturb it a lot, and it would be nice. Now, what's the problem? At Sørensen's interpretation of Grothendieck's inequality simply says that the quantum correlations are up to a constant classical correlations. And this constant is less than 2, 1.7, whatever. For dimension 2, it's square root of 2, and that's the square root of 2 we have seen this week a couple of times, right? I mean, the 3/4 and square root of 2 business. That, I mean, it's exactly attained for the CHSH. That's the worst case.
So you showed us how the binorm or the dual. Now you're saying that the gamma 2 captures the quantum.
This is, I mean, we observed that Sørensen, I can maybe write that down very quickly. I mean, so Sørensen realized that that Grothendieck's inequality implies that the gamma 2 star norm of z is less than the Grothendieck constant times the epsilon norm of z, right? That's a reformulation of Grothendieck's theorem. And this here exactly corresponds to the quantum value of the game. And this is the classical value of the game. So the classical value and the quantum value, they are related up to a factor at most 1.7 or something.
Sorry, but is there an analogous statement like what you just said for the quantum value of the game?
Yeah, I think
the quantum value is this gamma 2 star monster. We have just, you know, I can Let me, if that's possible, that's probably good. Right, so the gamma 2 star monster, which I gave just a strange name because it fits into my philosophy, but the gamma 2 star is right here, that monster. Yeah? And that is exactly, you know, this is exactly taking, you have, this is your game matrix, right? Here you're taking the supremum over all contractions, so you're taking the supremum over, that is the quantum value of the game, right?
Can you write it also as a dual?
Yeah, you can dualize everything. But so I mean, there are two inequalities. This one and that one. But of course, they are happening on different spaces, right? So this Z here is an L1M tensor L1M. And this Z here is an L infinity M tensor L infinity M. So depending on the space, these norms also change their meaning, right? They have two. So these are equivalent inequalities. And so you know what I taught before, I mean, what I said before is I mentioned this inequality. If you dualize it, it exactly translates into the fact that the quantum value is less than a constant times the classical value. And this constant is a quotient constant. I have this wonderful colleague in experimental colleague in my he had never heard of that. So you know, for experimentalists, this theorem is unknown, some of them. Yeah? So that you can only have a bounded amount of violation. Right? I mean, it can never be more than 2. The square root of 2 they can do, but you know, it's never gonna be more than 2.
But this applies only to 2-player XOR game though.
It only applies to correlations which corresponds to XOR games.
Yeah. The 2-player.
Yeah. Yeah.
Does the non-signaling value have fit into this nicely?
Hmm?
Does the non-signaling value fit into this framework?
Yes. Yes.
Great.
Okay. So, we are going forward. And we had that before, so.
Sorry, what would be the answer to this question?
The answer is, I'm not saying this. Right?
Is it not a different norm?
Yes, it's a different norm. It's the gamma 2 star norm on the dual. So it's that would. Yes, the answer is yes, okay?
I'm very happy to hear that.
Okay, so let's talk. Let's talk about what you just had, right? I mean, so multiplicative violation for 3 parties instead of 2 parties can be arbitrarily large. That's also my Spanish crowd, right? And there's a very nice, very nice concrete estimate, which I will not I will not write down. But now, you can even somehow restrict the number, the dimension of the Hilbert space, and make it not log by Breed and Dilley, right? So there's, I mean, now we had a very non-constructive proof, but they have a very probabilistic nice proof. So 3-party correlations can be arbitrarily large if you allow the number of questions to go to infinity, and of course, if you allow arbitrary amounts of entanglement. And it's somehow you should think of, you know, if the number of questions is n and the Hilbert space dimension is n, it's sort of square root of n. Yeah? Depending, I mean, I have to make this more precise. But so with 3 parties, unbounded violation, no problem with Grothendieck. I mean, he's not in the way anymore. He doesn't harm you to produce really very robust violations. So we like those better than CAs, HAs, but that's just personal. Now, if you go from correlation, so 2 XOR games to arbitrary number of questions, you can push this whatever you want. I mean, even with 2 parties, you have very large violations. We had a little competition of finding, you know, what is the best value. It was a lot of fun. But I mean, for those who are interested, you can ask later. I mean, so you know, you have questions, answers, dimension of entanglement. So there are 3 parameters. You know, now this becomes kind of technical, right? I mean, how much violation for how much? I mean, it's a trade-off business. So I mean, you understand there is something to be said. But I just, you know, I was supposed to do this briefly, so I'm doing this briefly. And so you know, this is why there are many other states which witness violation. I should probably also mention this paper. So with Carlos, we proved that in the realm of probabilities, you can have arbitrary large violation with almost no entanglement, meaning the it's a pure state, which is the witness of this violation, with entropy 1 over log n, is that right? Not log n, 1 over log n is really very little entropy, right? So violation and entropy, it's not the same thing. I mean, of course, if you have entropy 0, it's separable, but you don't need entropy to be large to have violation. Right, so if you want to understand what is the reason, I mean, how do you measure entanglement? You could measure with violations instead of entropy, and for some purposes, this could be a good idea. If you need some protocols which have robustness, well, just take one of ours and, you know, have fun calculating it. And then I mean, there's work to be done to make it, you know, applicable for some problems which I've seen this week, but there are other violations which are different from CHSH, which might be very interesting for some other applications. It's just not, that's not what we usually do. Anyway, okay, yeah.
So these results are of interest to us in quantum information, and Grothendieck's theorem was just purely of interest from the Banach space perspective. Like, are these estimates, when you translate them back into the norm language?
Yeah, they have a meaning.
They have meaning, but are they of interest to people who do Banach space theory?
Well, you know, okay, that, how much time do I have left? So this is, I mean, this story is really, I mean, it's really a nice story. So I was in a PhD defense for Javier Percet, which is, you know, almost a colleague of the people from Spain which are here. And so we wanted to do something else. And then I met David and Nacho, and we were talking about this very strange thing, which is somehow comparing min and epsilon norms for three tensors. You know, I did this, did some preliminary calculation at some point, and I was so sure that nobody in the world would be interested in it that I even, you know, it was kind of, you know, a private conversation, because in public I wouldn't dare to talk about it. That answers your question? That was the tripartite violation, right? And then David later came back and said, by the way, this might be interesting. Okay, so let me tell you how we view, you know, these quantum objects, how we put them in the language. And I have to remind you how we started this talk. So we started with the Banach space. What is a Banach space? Okay, what is an operator space? It's a subspace of the bounded operator of a Hilbert space, instead of an arbitrary Banach space. Now, if you say that doesn't mean a thing, because everything is a subspace of the bounded operators of a Hilbert space. But what happens if you have a subspace of the bounded operators of a Hilbert space, you have some extra information which comes for looking at matrices of operators. Matrices of operators carry a natural norm because they act on a larger Hilbert space, here, L to N of H. So an operator space is such a concrete operator space, is such a subspace which carries a sequence of norms. Now, I understand that this is a weird concept, but this was some of the transition which we had to make in order to talk about quantum objects instead of classical objects. So for now, an operator space is a space which has this kind of tail of names attached to it, right? I mean, which he carries around and annoys that all the time. So that's an operator space. Now, if you want to take care of these tail of norms, you see you have to, yeah?
Sorry, can I interrupt just for 1 second and try to say something? Which, what you have managed to do up there is you were looking at correlations, classical correlations, quantum correlations, and you found Banach tensor norms that characterized classical correlations and quantum correlations.
Well, the quantum correlations we could only characterize in that language, operator space language. So
probabilities.
I can come back to that in a second. Okay.
Okay.
It's canonical. We will have it 2 pages later. Okay.
This is the point here, right? We're trying to find.
Right. So the point here is to find another object, which I consider instead of Banach spaces, where if I compare Banach spaces with operator spaces, the question quantum correlation versus classical correlations is natural. It's a natural question, and then I will, you know, that gave us new tools to show that two norms are not the same, because we somehow compared the classical with the quantum, or the Banach spaces with the operator space universe, right? So I'm here just talking about the universe which I want to place myself in so that I can talk about quantum objects in a canonical way. And so the point here is that instead of the linear maps from X to Y, I have to use other maps. You see, if you have the same objects, you have to change the home. You have to change something, and here is the morphisms are changed. So we replace linear maps by what is called completely bounded maps. And since every operator space has this tail of matrix norms, so a map is completely bounded if it's bounded on every matrix level, and then you have a uniform bound. Yeah? So now you remember we proved that if X is a Banach space, then so is the dual. Or if Fx is a Banach space, then the linear maps from X to Y are a Banach space. This here is now a theorem from my colleague in Champaign-Urbana. So the space of completely bounded maps from X to Y is also an operator space. With the norm, the CB norms, the matrix of CB of XY are the CB maps from X to MN of Y. So there's just, you know, a canonical way to put a matrix norm on these monsters, and with that it's an operator space. Yeah? So it somehow embeds in B of H in some weird way. Okay. So examples for operator spaces, the bounded operators on the Hilbert space itself, column vectors, row vectors, diagonal vectors, right? I mean, these are good operator spaces. Now, if you apply this trick here and do the same trick as before, if X is an operator space, then the CB maps from X to C happen to be the same thing as, you know, linear maps are automatically completely bounded. It's also an operator space, right? That's what this theorem says. So suddenly, not only B of H is an operator space, but also the trace class operators is an operator space, which before was weird, right? I mean, B of H are operators. So I'm doing something weird because B of H, these are observables, and S of H, these are densities. This, you know, this lives in the other part of the Heisenberg picture, right? But now, densities are also observable. Okay, you start to understand why this is helpful, but also problematic, right? And because, you know, you identify densities with observables in some weird way, but the point is, it doesn't matter how we do it, it's just to have the language available here, which helps us, okay? So L1n is an operator space, and then we have this complete isometry, and I just play the same game, right? Tensor norms. I have two operator spaces, there should be a smallest one, a largest one, just repetition, right? Not parallel, but repetition. So the smallest reasonable operator space tensor norm, where I'm not defining that, okay? So I'm lying here, but you just have, what you do is you put X into B of H, Y into B of B, and then you take the norm, you know, the induced norm, and that is the right norm. That's the smallest possible norm. And the other one is defined operationally. You have two operator spaces, you take this projective thing, whatever it is, you take the dual. Before, in the Banach space category, these were the linear maps from X to Y. Now these are the CB maps from X to Y star. Yeah, so it's just copy, right? Find a norm which does that trick. And here is the real norm, which essentially answers your question. It's the Hargrove norm. So you can have a third norm, which somehow takes the infimum of all decompositions in row and column vectors. And the non-signaling norms, they're all related to these Hargrove norms. So that's why I didn't want to answer. You have to be careful and do this right, but this is where these guys come from. And then, you know, it's an operator space tensor norm, so it should be between min and the largest one, which traditionally we call wedge. I don't know. That's just the tradition. Okay, so we have those norms. And then the point is, right. So now we have a dictionary. And that's the dictionary which I was talking about. So correlations, the value of the game is the epsilon norm, the classical value. The quantum value is the min norm. So now this translates into something. And if you want to do it with three parties, you have L1 epsilon, L1 epsilon. And that is no longer the same thing as L1 min tensor L1 min tensor L1. Right? So for two, you just add tensors and replace epsilons by mins. And for two, they are equivalent by Grotony constants. For three, this fails. Probabilities, well, you know, L1 pi L infinity, epsilon L1 pi L infinity, classical value. Here I should have done projective, which is fine because they are the same. L1 projective, L infinity, and mine. So these two categories allowed us to compare classical values of probabilities with quantum values of probabilities. The classical values on the left, the quantum values on the right. And then, and more parties just means more tensors, right? So you know, it's Lego, right? You just put them together. Now, in this dictionary, you can also quantize spaces, not only norms, right? So what is a quantized L1? That's a trace class operator. What's a quantized L infinity? These are matrix algebras. And you can ask for, you know, is the classical and the quantum value of such a monster the same or not? Yes, spaces which look like that. Now, I'm not saying that you have to remember, oh, that's perfect, actually. I'm not saying you have to remember these norms. The only thing I want to say is now we have a language to actually give the quantum value of a quantum game with quantum questions and quantum answers a norm associated with it, right? You know, we have a norm for almost everything, not everything, but you will see, you know, quantum games, quantum questions, quantum answers has a place in our dictionary. That's what I want to explain. But you see, you can quantize not only norms, but objects. Commutative L1, non-commutative L1. Commutative L infinity, non-commutative L infinity. Pi tensor product, largest operator space tensor product. So it's not creative anymore, right? It's a dictionary, yeah? Of course, calculating these guys is a different story, right? I mean, I'm not saying that calculating these values is easy. I'm only saying we have a dictionary where these quantum values of quantum questions, quantum answers make sense. That's all, yeah? Actually, sometimes for me, if I see the operator space interpretation, it makes more sense than when I see the definition, but that's probably just me. Okay, there's a version of the Grothendieck theorem which says that if I calculate, you know, before we compared the largest projective norm on L infinity with some gamma 2 norm. The analog of the gamma 2 norm here is this Hagrup norm, but you have to allow the Hagrup norm is no longer symmetric. So if you flip it over, you get a different value. So now things become difficult because you have to take two Hagrup norms, not only one. The good thing is, thanks to... they are both SDPs, so it's okay, right? I mean, these norms which appear here are SDPs, so then, yeah, so the right-hand side is an SDP. Okay, quantum games. So let's, I've copied this from, hopefully not wrong, from some paper. So referee Charlie, I mean, for you it's a verifier, so, you know, when is this a referee and when a verifier? I will not understand that today, but, you know, somebody maybe will explain that to me. So we have a tripartite state. A part which belongs to Charlie, Bob, and Alice. Now, what do? We add an arbitrary entangled states in A prime, B prime. We apply registers from A prime A to A prime to A and B prime B to B. So that's of course important that the registers are done separately, right? I mean, Alice and Bob do not communicate; they do this separately. Although, of course, they have some shared entanglement in A prime, B prime. So you apply them, you get a new density, and then you check this new density against a reference projection, and that gives you the value of the game. The game, by the way, is simply this pair, C, A, B, C, and gamma, right? P, the projection, right? That's the projection in, yeah, that's the game. So let's see. That's a quantum game, by the way. So the quantum value, I gave it a star because there is a classical value for a quantum game. But we don't really have to discuss that. But so the maximum was taken over all possible channels, phi and psi, which act on the joint system, AA prime and BB prime separately. And of course, the amount of entanglement which we add. Right? Yeah, so that's the quantum value of the quantum game with quantum questions and quantum answers. Right. And so what I'm saying is you can actually write down, you know, the game is given by this object and this object. I can write down a tensor, right? You know, now it's a very large, well, these are finite dimensional spaces, so it's a super large matrix with a lot of coefficients. And this, the norm of that tensor there is the quantum value of the game, almost up to a constant 2, because Our testing only restricts to positive maps, and so there, you know, there's a little thing. I mean, there's a little white lie, but so actually, if you do it in the sense of operator spaces, it's fine. And then the next proposition is that every quantum game has a square root, right? I mean, you know, a positive definite matrix has a square root, sure, right? So this is some kind of positive matrix which has a square root, came funny square root. I'm not writing down the general square root, but for a rank one game, so rank one game is simply where this projection is rank one. Yeah, that's a rank one game. This projection is a rank one projection. The square root is this funny matrix. You write down your tripartite state. You do bra and ket with the tripartite state, and you trace out over everything which Charlie does. So what you end up is something which only lives in the Hilbert spaces related to Alice, Bob, Alice. Actually, you have them twice, Alice, Bob. I mean, they're doubled up. And if you then you calculate this value, and then it's the square of that matrix with respect to that norm. Now it's actually not a lie. There is no constant. And the good thing is that we didn't even have to invent them before. They were invented before. These are the quantum value of an XOR, quantum XOR game, right? So these matrices have another interpretation of quantum XOR games, and Thomas and Bragg have proved that they can be calculated with the polynomial time algorithm using the Grothendieck inequality, right? Sort of. Well, I'm not subscribing to that sentence, but the Grothendieck inequality, which was mentioned before, the operator space version, that was one of the first. Before it was just a beautiful result, but that's an application. Yeah. Okay, so we also have an application of this Grothendieck inequality. Because we have this translation, we can define what are called OH rank one games. Now, OH, that goes too far. I'm just saying there are some objects which I call OH rank one games, because what we do is the following thing. I can probably explain the following. This space, trace class operator, min trace class operator, that is an object which in the theory of operator spaces, the CB maps from bounded operators into trace class, we have studied for other reasons, right? I mean, if you want to study the class of operator spaces, you have to understand CB maps between these spaces. B of H is a canonical example. S1 of H is a canonical example. So studying CB maps there is sort of a canonical task for me, not for you. But for us, it was important. If you don't understand some concrete norms, you cannot do anything. So we have some objects in here which were natural and which we could identify. And if we take these objects here, they translate backwards into XOR games, quantum XOR games. And since we have the connection between the values, we can actually do calculations, right? So we calculated that norm instead of that norm, and then we can do calculations. And then as a result, you have a naive parallel repetition is completely wrong. So if you take the square root of the game, the tensor product of the game, then the value can be much bigger than that. I'm not saying parallel repetition is wrong, but this naive version is totally wrong, right? And that can be shown using OH games. And that's all what I have to say, because in mathematics, we don't do a conclusion, right? Yeah, they are open problems. There are some problems about certain Hargrove norms, which I would like, whether there are SDPs, that would be cool. I mean, there are many questions which we don't know. I mean, your result is very nice, but for some purposes, it's not enough to know. So, but I could formulate some of them.
Could you comment on the computational complexity of computing the minimum norm, the projection norm? Do you know anything about it?
No. Okay. No. For complexity, I need a translator. Yeah, I'm the translator from operator algebras to this games, and if you want to talk complexity class, then I need a translator. So if you want me to show an inequality for norms, tell me what you want, and then maybe it works. Right?
So, it will depend on the operator spaces you put. It's not just a property norm, but not the norm itself.
Right. So
there are operator spaces for which it's efficient, and other for which it's hard.
I mean, there are, for instance, definitely operator spaces where should be NP hard or whatever to calculate some very min. I mean, because the epsilon norms are part of the class is so large that some of the operator norms are also min norms, because we can tweak it in that way. And so if something is hard to calculate what the L4, L2 norm is a monster, right?
You can put
an operator space structure on these spaces so that the min norm is the epsilon norm. It's not, the canonical choice. And then you're as bad off as before.
Right. Well, obviously the case of interest is bipartite quantum operations.
Right, so for instance, what is not known is the complexity class of calculating how difficult is it to calculate that norm?
I can pass that.
Yeah? So that's the quantum value or the classical value of a quantum game, right? This you don't know, right? Or do you know it's hard? The two-partite quantum game is already hard. The classical quantum
value, yes, because it contains one.
The classical value, yes, but it's not known for the quantum value. I think that is open, right?
Exactly, it's
known.
Exactly. So it couldn't be.
Yeah, but up to a constant, or so we.
No, up to a constant.
Up to a constant, this thing here, we should expect this to be hard because we are giving so much, so you see, we are giving a lot of freedom here by doing these operations, right? So. And so in principle, there are also nice tricks which you can play with that. If you look at this expression, you can use teleportation and all of these tricks. Super dense coping, teleportation. This applies to these guys, and you can reduce the number of difficulties. Yeah. So, you can remove some quantum questions, make them quantum answers. I mean, you can remove some of them. I would have to sit down at which one. So you can avoid. I think you can replace quantum answers by classical answers without, in the same class of games.
Yeah. My motivation actually is different context. Actually, some version of the question is very critical for the power of so-called QMA2 class.
Yeah. Right.
So both in the classical and the quantum game is of interest to find out how much entanglement is needed.
Yes, sure, absolutely true.
Does it appear anywhere in your framework?
Like, yes, it does. You see, when I wrote my habilitation thesis, it's kind of when I learned about operator spaces, I introduced a norm which was min d, right? So which has here an index, and that's exactly the amount of entanglement. So that would say that you calculate this by just looking at maps which eventually go to in the d-dimensional. So that's exactly, so these have been considered before. It's just that this was too technical, I didn't include it here. But this can be formulated as well and has been used in different contexts. So if you have an operator space, you can somehow look for all maps from the operator space into the d by d matrices. And then, so you can somehow think of d entanglement, and that has a norm analog. Very similar to what David Cripps, they have also done similar, very similar things, but not exactly the same. So this can be formulated, yes. I mean, it does not always help, but it can. Yeah, sure.
You say that you can characterize all the non-singling correlations by using some weird form.
Yeah, I think I said that. Carlos knows that by heart, or he knew that by heart.
Okay.
Yeah, he can answer that. I mean, so I know a person who knows the answer, okay?
Good enough. Correlations, I mean, non-singularity correlations are just matrices which has all the entries bounded by one. I mean, those are the non-singularity correlations. I mean, another story is if you want to the non-singularity probability distribution, that is more difficult. But if you want to work in the correlation level, then it's just, I mean, those matrices such that all entries are bounded by one. Sorry?
I think the property level is...
Yeah, that is norm.
Yeah.
That, I don't think we have a good norm for that.
Is it not some gamma 2 star norm?
Not in the probability.
It's not related to gamma 2 star, I thought it was.
Okay, so... Up to my knowledge, it's not.
Yeah.
Question in terms of inequalities. There is a good bound on the operator norm in terms of the epsilon norm?
But in principle, no, right? I mean, it can be as far away as, I mean, you know, our first results, of course, somehow try to distinguish the two. You can always do something trivial. If your space is of dimension n, then you know, it's n. But that's essentially, you know, in whole generality, only the trivial estimates are true. I mean, it's, you know, at some point, if you want to show something interesting, you have to take more specific operator spaces and then show, like the Gortnik inequality, show something for very specific maps and for very specific operators, right? But in full generality, it's too much. I mean, you cannot even calculate the norm of a linear map, so leave alone an arbitrary, completely bounded map.
Anything if you have like separable operators, common combination of
Not also not in general, and some special cases maybe. Yeah, so we have, I mean, that can be, you know, you can formulate what separable, yeah, but it's all, and then you have to go to the specific. So if you have, you know, a concrete question, I could in some instances produce something, but I cannot promise something in full generality. This would just be hilarious. Yeah, I mean, the strategy is all this is only one way. I mean, two-way communication, that's all. Now, this is a one-way concept, but just to be sure, right?
Okay, then let's thank Marius again.